current state of the art of psychotherapy research, and with a focus on practice-based research, and then talking about the evidence base for the efficacy of psychotherapy. I'll review the evidence base for what makes psychotherapy work, particularly what are commonly called the common factors, and at least those that have the best research evidence. I'll discuss the need for practice-based research in psychotherapy, and then I'll talk to you about an initiative that we're developing called the Psychotherapy Practice Research Network, which is centered in Ottawa, but is a Canada-wide network of practice-based research. So in terms of the use of psychotherapy, over a million Canadians have used psychotherapy in any given year. That's about 3.7% of adults in Canada. The numbers are very similar in the US. And the rates of psychotherapy use have essentially remained the same over the past decade, despite the fact that antidepressant prescriptions have doubled in the same period of time. So antidepressants have gone from 5.3% to about a little over 10% in the 2000s, but the rate of psychotherapy use has remained the same during that same period of time. In terms of the efficacy of psychotherapy, the question here is whether or not psychotherapy is effective. Is it more effective than no treatment or than nothing, essentially? The best evidence in this regard are from a series of meta-analyses. Meta-analyses are meta-analyses of meta-analyses, so it's an aggregation of meta-analytic studies. And meta-analyses are an important way of aggregating data, primarily from a variety of studies, primarily because it turns the effects found in each individual study into a common metric called an effect size, often characterized by Cohen's D. And then one is able to aggregate these across numerous studies. And so the error variance that's typical of any particular study gets essentially aggregated, and you can get a distribution of effect sizes. In any case, that's why we look at meta-analyses, and which are preferable to individual studies when you're trying to make a decision about evidence-based practice. These two meta-analyses go back a number of years now, but they reviewed about 25 to 68 meta-analytic studies, respectively, that look at psychotherapy versus no treatment. The average effect size was large. Cohen's D of 0.8 is large, essentially, and that's sort of the cutoff criteria for a large effect. And how do you interpret that? Well, basically, that essentially means that the average psychotherapy patient is better off than 79% of untreated controls, or another way to characterize that is it's a 69% rate of success due to psychotherapy. Or another way of looking at it is that 14% of the outcome variance is attributable to the effect of psychotherapy. These all essentially mean the same, are equivalent, and they all indicate a large effect of psychotherapy. Just to put the effect sizes into some context, the effect sizes are essentially as large as or larger than most common medical procedures. So the use of statins in cardiology, various procedures in geriatric medicine, interventions for asthma, aspirin as a prophylaxis for heart attacks, and influenza vaccine, cataract surgery, and so on. So there's a long list of these, but essentially that's just to give you an example and to put the effects of psychotherapy into some context. A question that often people ask is, what's the cost effectiveness of psychotherapy? It's another way of judging whether it's worth it or not, I guess. These are numbers that many of you are likely aware of, that 1 in 5 Canadians will experience a mental illness in their lifetime, and the remaining 4 out of 5 know someone who has had or has a mental illness. In Canada, mental illness is the second leading cause of human disability and premature death. The estimated costs are about $51 billion to the Canadian economy. These are both direct and indirect costs. The lifetime incident, if we look at specifically at major depression, the lifetime incidence is about 8.6%. And there's a very nice book by Lazar, 2011, published by the American Psychiatric Press, looking at cost effectiveness of psychotherapy across a variety of conditions. And typically the metric used is quality of adjusted life years. This is a health economics metric that not only looks at how long people live, but also adjust that for the quality of life, essentially. And there are many, many studies now that demonstrate the cost effectiveness of psychotherapy for depression, for example, in terms of quality of adjusted life years gained, decreased disability, and decreases of days spent in hospital. There's also some evidence for cost offset. Cost offset is a very conservative way of looking at this kind of data. It basically one has to look at not only is it effective, but also is the cost of providing psychotherapy, is the effectiveness over and above the cost of providing the psychotherapy is essentially what it is. And there's a number of studies now that provide some evidence for that, including a study that we did that's not published yet on the cost effectiveness of group treatment for depression and binge eating disorder. The next issue that often people discuss in these kinds of talks is the relative efficacy of psychotherapy. This is a particular issue that takes up a lot of energy among researchers and clinicians. In other words, are there differences in outcomes between the different treatments that are treatment types that are offered? The meta-analyses of 32 meta-analyses were conducted by Wample, both in 97 and 2002. Now, he only included bona fide treatments, right? There are a number of studies out there where a particular treatment is compared to a sham, essentially, or what Weston called an intent to fail context. But if you only look at bona fide treatments, the effects tend to be small. The Cohen's D is about 0.2. This is a small effect, accounting for about 1% of the variance in the outcome data. This is consistent for a number of disorders, including anxiety disorders and depression. When you partial out researcher allegiance, this is pretty easy to do. It's pretty easy to figure out what the researcher's allegiance is. Usually, they've written the manual or they've published other things of a particular treatment. And so if you partial that out of the analysis, then the differences between treatments becomes essentially negligible. There's very little difference between treatment types. The differences are small. You partial out researcher effects, they become very small. If you partial out therapist effects, they disappear completely. Let me say that this is a contentious conclusion that I've come to, not that I've come to, that many people have come to. People disagree with this, right? There's a lot of debate about this issue. If you look at dropout statistics, a very recent meta-analysis of dropouts that just actually came out this week, essentially finds the dropout rates across different therapy types to be equivalent, usually at about 19%. So as I said, the question about the relative efficacy of therapies has been an extremely, extremely divisive debate over the past 40 or 50 years that, in my view and the view of many others, has really led to inconclusive results at best, but has also led to a lot of acrimony, bad feelings, and so on. It's been a nasty debate that has not really served anyone, in my opinion, very well. So let's look at the relative efficacy of psychotherapy and psychopharmacologies, and I'll focus specifically on antidepressants. There are now a number of meta-analyses regarding these comparisons. Essentially, both in terms of the effectiveness of both psychotherapy and SSRIs are more effective than a placebo. That's a pretty common finding now. And when bona fide psychotherapies are looked at, the effects of psychotherapy and SSRIs do not differ. They're both equivalent in terms of their effectiveness. When you look at moderators of this, this is true for chronic versus non-chronic depression. It's true for across the range of the severity of depression. And there's all, however, there's some evidence for superiority of SSRIs for dysthymia, but the effects are quite small, which makes you wonder about the clinical meaningfulness of that particular difference. On the other hand, psychotherapy has better long-term outcomes at follow-up than antidepressants. And the dropout rates are lower for psychotherapy than for antidepressants. And according to one author, that psychotherapies seem to produce less resistance to multiple administrations. In other words, if a client or a patient has multiple courses of either, there tends to be less problems with psychotherapy. The summary so far of this literature is so psychotherapy is effective compared to no treatment, that about 79% of treated patients are better off than the average non-treated patient, that psychotherapy is cost effective in terms of improving quality of adjusted life years, and there's also some evidence for cost offset. There's no consistent evidence for any form of psychotherapy being more effective than any other for most conditions. The effect sizes are small. However, as I mentioned, it's a pretty contentious conclusion. And psychotherapy outcomes for depressive symptoms are as good as SSRIs in the short term and somewhat better in the longer term. So where does that leave us in terms of psychotherapy research and what to do about psychotherapy? As I said, much of the research literature over the last 40 years and research money, as I'll show you shortly, has been really focused on randomized controlled trials of various psychotherapies in terms of which therapy is better. There is also a fairly large literature now on factors within psychotherapies that lead to good outcomes. Common factors generally refer to those factors that reliably lead to positive outcomes that are inherent in any psychotherapeutic situation and not specific to any one therapy approach. And these include three different areas. The first is the relationship, which might include things like therapeutic alliance and receiving client feedback, which gets lumped in that relationship category. The second has to do with the therapist, the second area, which includes a variety of things. A couple of things that I'm going to talk about has to do with the therapist's allegiance to their approach or their belief in the effectiveness of the therapy that they're providing, and empathy. And then a variety of patient factors, including severity of the disorder or the symptoms, the expectation of benefit, which is sometimes called the placebo effect, or unfortunately called the placebo effect, belief in the credibility of the therapy and the therapist, and patient variables, and I'm going to talk about attachment because it's a particular interest of mine. So these are the common factors as in terms of the percent of total outcome variance that are accounted for by these factors, not just common factors. This one's may look a little troubling, but isn't all that unusual. The 40% is unexplained variance. And this is not unusual in any research area, so I wouldn't be too shocked by it, although it does look like a large number. And this really refers to measurement error, right? So the things we measure are not particularly, not always sensitive or always accurate. Statistical error related to the research design, And you know, the catch-all of the complexity of human behavior. Basically, we don't know everything about humans, and so there's error inherent in that. The second largest category is the patient contribution. These include a variety of things, as I said before, including the severity of the symptoms and other patient characteristics. So a large chunk of the outcome variance in psychotherapy is attributed to what the patient brings with him or her to the therapy. And the therapy relationship is about 12%. That includes things like therapeutic alliance. The differences between treatments, the efficacy, the relative efficacy issue is about 8% of the variance. Therapist effects is about 7% of the variance. I've seen some studies, though, as high as 15% for that one. And then 3% is a bunch of other things that can't be really categorized, and they account for a very small amount of the variance. So that these are essentially the issues that, in terms of the best evidence for our understanding of what contributes to therapy outcomes, this is how the pie gets split up. My favorite statistic of this talk is this one, that 80% of NIH dollars for psychosocial intervention research goes towards that 8% of the slice of that pie, right? So most NIH dollars, and this is probably true in Canada as well, most of the dollars for psychotherapy research goes towards comparing treatments against each other for a particular disorder. But most of the outcome variance is attributed by a large number of other things. So I'd like to go through these common factors in a little more detail and review the research evidence for them. Some of this comes from an interesting task force that was put together by the American Psychological Association, headed by John Norcross. John is actually going to be in Ottawa next Friday, April 27th, giving a public lecture at the School of Psychology at the University of Ottawa. So those of you who are interested, you could send me an email and I can send you the information about that. He headed this task force that was put together by the Division of Psychotherapy and the Division of Clinical Psychology at the American Psychological Association. The interesting thing about these two divisions, that the Division of Psychotherapy is largely, their bias tends to be more psychodynamic and interpersonal. The Division of Clinical Psychology's bias tends to be cognitive behavioral. So you've got two very diverse groups in terms of their particular therapy biases coming together and looking at what the relationship factors are that contribute to good outcomes in psychotherapy. They had a list of what they described as demonstrably effective factors. These include the therapeutic alliance in both individual, family, and youth therapy, the group therapy version of that, which is group cohesion, therapist empathy, and collecting patient feedback. They also found probably effective. This means that the evidence isn't as strong or there aren't as many studies related to these. These are very Carl Rogers kind of factors of gold consensus, collaboration, and positive regard. And then a number of three other promising areas with insufficient evidence. This mainly means that the number of studies are small, not that the evidence isn't good. This has one having to do with therapist congruence or genuineness, repairing alliance ruptures, which is mainly the work of Jeremy Safran out of New York, and managing countertransference, which mainly comes from Jeff Hayes' work. I'm going to talk about the ones that are in bold in a little more detail because there's more evidence for them. In terms of the therapeutic alliance, it's defined as the agreement on the tasks and goals of therapy and the bond between therapist and patient. That's sort of the common definition of therapeutic alliance. It really emphasizes the conscious aspects of the relationship, like collaboration and consensus. Meta-analysis done by Horvath in 2011 had 200 studies in it. They only included studies with bona fide treatments. They found a medium effect size for therapeutic alliance predicting treatment outcome, which is meaningful. A medium effect size is meaningful. In particular, therapeutic alliance early in therapy and late in therapy were the most related to outcomes. Middle set therapeutic lines in the middle of therapy was not, probably because the middle of therapies, usually the therapists engage in more interventions and maybe the alliance is a little not quite as strong there. I don't know. That's kind of a speculation, but that would make sense. There's no difference between different types of psychotherapy and that alliance and outcome relationship. And as I said earlier, there's emerging evidence that recognizing and repairing alliance ruptures improves treatment outcomes. And Safran has a very specific clinical intervention guidelines with regard to that. They include, and I kind of agree with this, including collecting patient feedbacks as a relationship issue, because it does affect the relationship and it sets up a particular type of relationship between a patient and therapist. And this involves regularly monitoring and tracking patient treatment response with self-report measures and then giving the feedback to the therapist immediately after that. It's thought to provide therapists with a week-to-week summary of patient functioning, but it also, I think, improves the therapist's responsiveness to patients who are not getting better. Right. Therapists are notoriously bad at identifying patients who are getting worse. I'll describe that in a minute. Here it is. So in a large study by Lambert, he had several hundred patients in this study. In an HMO, 20% of them got worse. Only 8% of that 20% were identified by the therapist as getting worse. Right. So therapists are not able to identify their patients who are getting worse, except for a small percentage, and these are probably the extreme cases. In terms of collecting patient feedback, there was a large meta-analysis by Lambert and colleagues, including 13 studies and over 2,000 patients. The effect size is medium for the effect of giving therapists immediate and weekly feedback on how their patients are doing from a standardized self-report measure from the patient. I think particularly interesting in terms of this issue of patients who deteriorate, that the number of patients who deteriorated went from 20% to 9% for those therapists who received immediate feedback in this way. So it seems to help therapists identify these patients and do something to help them. The other issue, the last issue in terms of common factors that I'll talk about has to do with therapist effects. These are differences between therapists and usually account for, well, according to Norcross, about 7% of the outcome variance. I have though seen other meta-analyses by Bruce Wampold where the effect is higher than that, almost double that. In other words, therapists differ in their patients' outcomes, right? I'm not sure why people are sometimes surprised by that, but some therapists are better than others. In fact, in a large study by Krauss, they had 700 therapists in a very large HMO in the US. They randomly selected 10 patients from each therapist's caseload. So they had 7,000 patients in this one study. Somewhere between 11 and 38% of therapists on average, their average patient got worse than from the beginning to the end of treatment, right? When they use a fairly stringent definition of a reliable negative change, which they described as harm, causing harm, 16% of the therapists among those 700 reliably had patients who got worse. Now, on the flip side of that, somewhere between 29 and 67% of therapists reliably had patients who got better, right? So depends on how you want to look at this. Maybe it's a good news story, maybe not. But anyway, it's cautionary to some extent that there's differences between therapists in terms of their patients' outcomes. The other issue is the therapist allegiance, which I mentioned earlier, and this is the therapist's belief in the credibility and effectiveness of the therapy they're providing. A meta-analysis looking at this particular issue found a medium effect size of the effect of allegiance on outcome. Some people, like Bruce Wumpold, argue that the effect of allegiance is quite a bit larger on outcome. The effect is larger than seen in the differences between treatment types. Therapist empathy is one that's often studied as well. This is by Rogers' definition, the therapist's sensitive ability and willingness to understand the client's thoughts, feelings, and struggles from the client's point of view. This is a pretty common definition. It's not the only one, but it's a common one. A meta-analysis of this issue included 57 studies. The effect size was medium in the sense that measuring therapist empathy was it predicted treatment outcomes. A couple of moderators also appeared. The patient's rating of the therapist empathy was a better predictor of outcome than the therapist's rating of their own empathy, right? In other words, if you're interested in the effect of empathy, don't ask the therapist, ask the patient, right? I guess it counts for them more than it counts for the therapist. Less experienced therapists had a bigger empathy outcome relationship. In other words, it seemed to be more important if you were earlier in your career or just starting out the effect of empathy seems to be more important. I don't think that suggests that if you're a later stage in your career, you can forget about being empathic. I think it just means that it's something that younger folks in the profession need to pay particular attention to, and maybe those engaged in training them need to pay particular attention to that issue as well. And again, no differences between treatment types in the empathy outcome relationship. The next common factor I'll talk about has to do with the patient. And remember, this one accounted for the largest amount in terms of the individual common factors. It accounted for the most outcome variance. I'm going to talk about attachment style because it's what I do and I like talking about it. And so here we go. It's not the only variable, obviously, but it's the one that I'd like to talk about. This has to, very briefly, attachment style encompasses patients' interpersonal style, affect regulation, coherence of mind, and they can be characterized as either secure or insecure. There's a developmental basis for these as well, and there's a large literature on it. And insecure attachments can be characterized as avoidant or anxious, or some people characterize them as dismissing and preoccupied. It's largely the same, or for our purposes, very similar. Higher attachment security is associated with better outcomes. Higher attachment anxiety is associated with worse outcomes. These are meta-analysis done by Levy very recently, Ken Levy. Attachment avoidance was not associated with treatment outcome, but there's several studies now, some of them, my own research looking at attachment avoidance and dropping out, and finding that people with high attachment avoidance tend to drop out of therapy at a higher rate. This is in binge eating disorder and in day treatment for anorexia and bulimia. Severity of problems is another area that's often looked at in terms of predicting treatment outcomes from the patient point of view, in terms of the patient factors. Things like functional impairment and severity of symptoms are associated with poorer outcomes. That doesn't come as any surprise, I suppose, to anyone. And also comorbid personality disorder, history of sexual abuse, also associated with poorer outcome and premature termination. So that's the common factors that I wanted to review, and mainly I wanted to review them because I think they're an area that is much more interesting and potentially more fruitful in terms of psychotherapy research, particularly practice-based research. What are the practice-based implications of that research? There's an evidence base for common factors in psychotherapy. I want to emphasize that common factors, I should have said this earlier, do not refer to common sense on the part of therapists. And it does not refer to being nice either. It refers to the issues that I referred to earlier, which has to do with therapeutic alliance, genuineness, empathy, congruence, therapist factors, and the various patient factors. There are practice-based implications. One might seem obvious: to develop a therapeutic alliance and be attentive to that early on and to attempt to maintain it throughout treatment. The sub point there really, again, comes from work that's emerging out of Jeremy Safran's lab, that one needs to recognize alliance ruptures, to do it quickly, and to repair them quickly, and not to ignore them. A number of times I'm asked to, by a colleague or particularly someone newer in the profession, for a consultation on a particular patient or a particular group, and when we talk it through, and we get to the details of what happened, why things are not working, it's usually related to a rupture of some kind, that something happened where the patient has lost confidence in the therapist, essentially, or has felt slighted by the therapist. And oftentimes the therapist is either aware of it, doesn't know what to do, or not entirely aware of it until it gets discussed in more detail in a supervision context. The second practice-based implications of this research is that the therapist have to maintain an empathic stance. So this, you know, there's a fair bit of clinical research on that, clinical writing about this, but the research bears that out in a very big way. And if you're interested in empathy, ask the patient, right? Don't rely on your own evaluation of your own empathy. It's really from the patient's point of view that matters. It's particularly important for newer psychotherapists or those in training to talk about this or to learn about it. And I didn't cover these research areas at all, but there are very negative effects of therapist behaviors, therapist hostility, confrontations, and treatment rigidity. In other words, sticking to a treatment plan at all costs. These are all related to poorer outcomes and likely are related to negative empathy or negative effects of poor empathy. Another practice-based implication is the notion of systematically collecting session-to-session patient outcomes on a regular basis and reporting these back to the therapist. This seems to have an impact on outcomes, and it in particular reduces the number of patients who get worse. Patients and therapists should believe in what they're doing. And this is, again, I think a particular issue for those who are newer to the profession and are just starting out and are not really sure about what they're doing, or those who are being supervised. I think it's very helpful to know the research evidence, which is very positive for psychology. Well, very positive. It's as positive as it gets for interventions. And I think the therapist's sense of confidence in what they're doing will instill hope in the patient and therefore improve their outcomes. And of course, being aware of patient factors, particularly with regard to severity and comorbidity, these need to be assessed early, very early on, and treatment needs to be adjusted to those issues. Right? And there are some practice-based reviews of these, and I with I guess with without any shame refer to one of my own with regard to that. That essentially reviews the common factors literature and the practice-based implications of that particular research. One of the issues that I'd like to talk to you about today is the fact that psychotherapy research doesn't always often doesn't translate into clinical practice. This is a huge problem in the psychotherapy practice field. There is a translational gap that I think, and that many think, reduces the effectiveness of psychotherapy as it's currently practiced. I use the word translational gap very deliberately. Some people say dissemination. The problem with the word dissemination is that it's a one-way conversation. It's the psychotherapy researchers in the Health Sciences Center, you know, essentially trying to get a message down to the clinician. Right? The translational gap is somewhat different. It has to do with a problem in communication between on both sides, and I'll talk about that as we go along. I'll talk about it now. There are several barriers to translating psychotherapy research into clinical practice. One of them is that clinicians perceive randomized controlled trials of psychotherapy as not generally or often perceive these as not particularly relevant to their practices or to their patients. Right? In other words, the exclusion criteria in many randomized controlled trials tend to be narrow, and clinicians feel that these then exclude patients with multiple comorbidities that they will see in their practices, or that the treatments being offered in these RCTs are very very time limited, very narrowly focused on one particular issue that again is not entirely related to the patients they see. This is again from the clinician's point of view. And many surveys will attest to this particular belief among clinicians. I have to say that I am sympathetic to that view. There are some issues there. I work in a tertiary care center for eating disorders, and to do a 12-session psychoeducational intervention for bulimia nervosa with a patient who's got a number of comorbidities, including self-harm and substance abuse problems, doing that kind of intervention that was tested in RCT in that context just doesn't make a whole lot of sense. Maybe later on it might for that particular patient. So I can sort of see some of the difficulties that clinicians have with randomized controlled trials. The problem, though, is that there's a baby and bathwater phenomena happening, is that many times clinicians ignore all the research that's out there. Right? Not just the randomized trials, but just about everything that's available. So the research evidence for things like identifying and repairing alliance ruptures also doesn't get translated into clinical practice. And that's a very clinically relevant research area. The other issue, I think, is that clinicians, and this again is borne out by a number of national and international surveys, clinicians feel patronized by researchers who often talk down to them. The unfortunate message in a number of dissemination type articles is a health sciences researcher saying, you should be doing this, right, to the clinician. And the clinicians, of course, you know, don't tell me what to do, which is a natural human reaction. A second barrier is that researchers, related to what I've already said, have not always valued what clinicians have to say in terms of clinical practice. Clinicians see many, many more patients than a researcher does, even a researcher who sees patients in their practice. But clinicians rarely get asked to join research teams in psychotherapy research context. It's usually, if you look at the co-authors of these randomized controlled trials, they often are health sciences researchers and not, you know, a full-time private practice clinician. And I already sort of alluded to the issues of an ivory tower approach to research with little attention of practical implications for the clinician. The third barrier is very particular to psychotherapy. The first two are actually common in a number of research areas, but the third one is very particular to psychotherapy, in that the psychotherapy profession is very, very diverse. Right? There are practitioners from many disciplines. And if you just think about it, psychology, psychiatry, GPs, social workers, counselors, drug counselors, I mean, the list goes on. You can probably name a dozen by, if you think about it. These professions work under a number of different professional practice standards. They're all trained differently. They're in terms of practice training, but also in terms of their understanding and use of research. So it's not a very cohesive profession, if you want to call it a profession. There are turf battles, and very bad turf battles, and what I would call professional chauvinism that occurs with regard to psychotherapy. And the patients we see are varied, right? It's not one intervention for one type of patient. It's a number of interventions for a variety of types of patients. And the settings we work in vary, right? Private practice offices, rehab centers, hospitals, and so on. One way of dealing with these barriers is to engage in practice-based research. And that means, the practice-based research has had a long history in family medicine in the US and in Canada. This is a collaborative approach to research in which research questions and methods are primarily driven by clinicians. The research is carried out by clinicians and researchers in community-based practice settings, although it doesn't have to be community-based practice settings, but that's often where it occurs, especially for family practice. It's very much a bottom-up approach to research, as opposed to top-down, which is very common in psychotherapy research. In other words, the ideas and the methods and the practical issues are driven by the practitioners and not necessarily by the researchers. And so one of the reasons I want to talk to you today is about the Psychotherapy Practice Research Network. And this is a network that we're developing, we're in the process of developing now in Ottawa. But it's a national. It will be a national network. This is an approach in which community-based psychotherapists collaborate with researchers to define the research questions for psychotherapy and to implement studies. Right. It results in scientifically valid research that's clinically meaningful. It's effectiveness research, so they're not RCTs. They're really about, you know, predicting outcomes or looking at what happens within the therapy context. It's interdisciplinary. It's patient-focused, patient-centered. It's clinician-driven. And so for all those reasons, we'll have a higher impact on real-world settings, on what happens in psychotherapy. Phase one will involve a psychotherapy research priority setting process. This is essentially where clinicians, researchers, educators, and other stakeholders will get together to define what the research priorities are for psychotherapy. We're gonna do this by holding a conference on November 17th, 2012 in Ottawa to define psychotherapy research priorities. There'll be some presentations in the morning. Dr. Louis Castonguay from Penn State is coming, and he will be talking to us about practice-based research. In the afternoon, however, there'll be breakout groups in which people attending the conference, hopefully most of them will be clinicians, will act as as a number of focus groups that will define what the research priorities are for them, right? So the clinicians, again, defining what they think is important in terms of psychotherapy research for their practice. There'll be two national surveys to rank order the priorities, and then a follow-up conference to finalize the priorities and also to talk about the practical issues of doing practice-based research. So a number of clinicians, for example, will wonder, how do I do this in my busy practice when I'm seeing X number of patients a day? These are solvable problems that can be overcome with enough manpower and enough money, essentially. Phase two will be, so phase one is the developing the research priorities from the clinician's point of view. Phase two, we'll engage in practice-based research based on those priorities that were identified by the clinicians and educators and researchers. And this is, we're probably looking 18 months to 2 years from now to enter into this phase of the project. This will involve research in community practices in which clinicians are full partners. There'll be collaborators on grants. There'll be co-authors on publications, right? If a publication has 25 co-authors, then it'll have 25 co-authors. But that's the way it will be. It's important, I think, for researchers. What researchers will get out of it is that they'll be engaged in more, I think, more meaningful and clinically practical research. Clinicians, I think, will there'll be a number of ways I think they'll benefit. One is that I think their practice will benefit by being involved in a research process. They will understand and be part of and create the cutting edge research that will influence practice. And patients, who ultimately are the people we're working for, will benefit from the state of the art of psychotherapy practice that's informed by the latest research. So just to end up, this is our website, pprnet.ca. It's in its beta version right now. It's going to be migrated to the University of Ottawa Faculty of Medicine site within the next week, I hope. It'll be much nicer looking, but all the information's there now. So please visit it. Have a look at what's there. Send us an email letting us know that you want to be on our mailing list, and we will be happy to keep you updated on what's happening. Come to the conference. It's November 17th, 2012. It's a Saturday. It's free, right? There's no fee to attend. It's on a Saturday, so practitioners can attend. There's free parking. There's free food. We've done everything we can to make this as approachable and as attendable as possible. And you can register at the website. So thank you.